Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. So myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs, and I have brought to you some questions that can be of use for your RBI SEBI and NABARD examination. So guys, before moving ahead, let me inform you all that you can download this PDF via the Telegram channel of ours, and the link of the channel is in description below. Before moving ahead, I have one most important information for you all is that the topic that I have chosen for the GK factory today is really very interesting, and because of that topic only, I'm so happy that I have got this opportunity of GK factory to discuss with you about that topic. So meri khushi se hi andaaza laga lo kitna interesting topic hoga, aur guess karte raho till the end that which topic am I going to discuss with you until or unless I reach there. Okay, so but before that, also mention, pay attention to this thing, that the questions that I'm going to discuss are very important from your exam point of view. So do not just go astray and think about the GK factory only, because you have to pay attention to the questions as well. So let's begin with the first question. With which country has India partnered to launch the technology-based energy solutions innovation for net zero? So guys, this is basically an initiative through which the technologies which can help India transition to clean and renewable energy will be developed. And it has been launched with a country. So which country is it? It is USA. Okay, so USA and India have partnered for this, because India has a goal to become a net zero emission country by the year 2070. So basically this initiative aims to develop the technologies and implement those technologies in India which can help India in generating clean and renewable energy, which also develops the infrastructure for India to store that energy generated from the renewable sources, carbon sequestration, that is to absorb the carbon, that the amount of carbon that we are releasing into the atmosphere. That is the only precise meaning of being the net zero emission country. Climate and clean energy challenge. So basically all this will help to tackle the climate and clean energy challenge that India is facing right now. The funding for this initiative will be given by United States India Science and Technology Endowment Fund, in partnership with Social Alpha, which is a non-profit organization promoting science and technology entrepreneurship. The new program is very much aligned with the US-India strategy for clean energy, basically US-India strategic clean energy partnership. So this partnership is very important between India and USA, and we have discussed this, guys, many a times in the Spotlight magazine, also in your PIP 247 session, in morning this session as well. So I'm not going to go into the details of it again. You can read it from the Spotlight magazine, where the entire information related to India, US-India strategic clean energy partnership is given. But for the timing, do memorize this thing, that this program is aligning with the goals of the partnership that India has established with USA. It will be administered by Indo-US Science and Technology Forum. Okay, so that was all about this initiative. It was quite an easy initiative, okay, from the exam perspective. Moving on to the second question, which of the following institution is not partnering for the Unified Logistics Interface Platforms Hackathon Logistics? Okay, Niti Aayog Atal Innovation Mission, Confederation of Indian Industry, National Industrial Corridor Development Corporation, NICDC Logistics Data Bank Services Limited. Here the right answer is option C. Confederation of Indian Industry has nothing to do with this hackathon, which has been organized by the Department for Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade. Okay, so the basic purpose of this hackathon, or for that matter any hackathon, is organized for inviting the innovative solutions from industry, from startups, from academics, okay, from academicians, so that we can work on the present issue that is there. And here the issue is the cost of logistics. So guys, do you know that at present the cost of logistics in India is 14% of the GDP? which is very high, because this is the logistic cost that ultimately is borne by the customers, and therefore this is basically hampering the overall consumption as well as exports of India. And if we want to increase the consumption, we want to increase the GDP and increase our exports, we need to reduce the logistics cost. And because of this reason, India has been launching many initiatives for the past years, like we have Freight Smart Cities Initiative, then we have also industrial corridors that are being developed. There are a total of 11 industrial corridors that will be developed across the country in order to reduce the freight charges, the logistics cost. So that's the whole idea behind having this hackathon, to invite more and more innovative solutions to reduce the logistics cost. Now, the very important component of this hackathon is that they are going to develop a platform, okay? A transparent platform that will provide all the information related to logistics to all the stakeholders. So it will basically reduce the logistic cost, first of all, by informing, by getting the information in real time. Obviously, the stakeholders, the manufacturers and the wholesalers and whatever stakeholders are involved in the logistics would get information at time, and this will definitely reduce their logistics cost. So that's the basic idea behind launching this hackathon, to develop the platform. So that was all about this initiative. Moving ahead, where will the second high-level international conference on the International Decade for Action, Water for Sustainable Development 2018 to 2028 be held? So basically, this is the entire name of the conference that is going to be held in Dushanbe, which is the capital of Tajikistan. Okay, so the year in which this will be held is 2022. Obviously, 2021 is not left now, right now. So we have New Year just around the corner. Do mention in the comment section what are your New Year resolutions in terms of studies, in terms of your goals. So moving ahead, the announcement of that high level conference was made at this India Central Asia Dialogue, which was held in New Delhi. So recently, the third edition of this meeting was held in New Delhi under the chairmanship of External Minister of India, that is S. Jaishankar. So guys, I hope that you all know that these are the ministers, the Central Asian leaders are invited as the chair, not the chairperson, the chief guest for Republic Day 2022. Okay, so do not forget that fact. The first edition of this dialogue was held in 2019, and this is basically to strengthen the bond between India and the Central Asian countries. So now let's have a look at the relationship between India and Central Asia. So guys, 2022 marks the 30 years of India's diplomatic relationship with the Central Asian countries. Last year, India has announced a line of credit of $1 billion to develop the infrastructure and other projects which are of social importance in the Central Asian nations. So guys, do not forget that 2020 was the very turbulent year. And in this year, we took care of the neighbors of ours, the distant neighbors, although, but still we took care of these countries and assigned a line of credit of $1 billion in order to strengthen the relationship with these Central Asian countries. Okay, so that is one fact or evidence of the relationship between India and the Central Asian countries. Next is that India is already running this Indian Technical and Economic Cooperation Program for capacity building and human resource development in the Central Asian countries, especially in information technology and communication skills in the English language. So this initiative was also appreciated during this India Central Asia dialogue. Now, what are the upcoming events that were discussed during this dialogue? So we have already discussed that the second high level international conference on International Decade for Action, Water for Sustainable Development 2018 to 2028 will be held in June 2022. Okay, so that's the one upcoming event. Now, guys, this is a preparatory meeting for the participants for the UN conference on mid-term comprehensive review of the implementations of the objectives of water decade in New York 2023. I know that all these things have crammed your mind right now. So let me simplify. There would be a high-level international conference on the progress made on International Decade for Action, which is 2018 to 2028. The theme of this conference would be water for sustainable development. So that's the entire issue here. That's the entire statement here. Okay, so this is the high-level meeting between India and the Central Asian countries to prepare for another meeting that will be held in 2023. And the title of that meeting is UN Conference on Midterm Comprehensive Review of the Implementation of the Objectives of the Water Decade. That is this. Okay, so basically this is going to be a review meeting. How many objectives have we achieved in terms of water sustainability and conservation of water? So that's the whole event list here. Next is that the participants, that is India and the Central Asian countries, have also expressed their supports to declare 2025 as the International Year of Glacier Conservation. Now, guys, pay attention that this is just a proposal. Okay, UN has not announced 2025 as the International Year of Glacier Conservation. Okay, so at the present moment, it is just a proposal from India and Central Asian countries to declare 2025 as this year, the year of glacier conservation, and create an international foundation for the protection of glaciers. Again, these two are the proposals that they will put forward in the 2023 UN meeting for the review of the actions taken in the water decade. So that was all about the India Central Asia dialogue. Moving ahead, where is Rishikesh University, India's first social impact university, located? So recently this university was inaugurated by the Premier of India. So we have Delhi NCR, Pune, Surat, Chandigarh, Hyderabad in the options. The right answer is Delhi NCR. Although, guys, the exact location is Sonipat, Haryana, but there are some news articles that were saying that this university has been inaugurated in Delhi NCR. Therefore, I have put it in the bracket, but the exact location where this university is located is Sonipat, Haryana. So do remember this thing. Next is the Chancellor Suresh Prabhu, who has already acted as a former minister in the union ministry in the central government. The purpose of this university is to inculcate Indian values and the wisdom of the past. Okay, so guys, here I would like to take a few minutes of yours to just clarify you the idea behind having this Rishikesh University. Many of you might be thinking that it is just another way of increasing the Hinduism or pushing forward the Hinduism on other religions or communities, whatever you want to say. But in my opinion, this is a very good initiative in order to reinvigorate our own wisdom, our own culture. India's culture is very rich. It's full of wisdom. Okay. And if any government or anything, we can say through this medium of this university, that culture is again recreated and reintroduced among the youth of India, then what could be better than this? So in my opinion, this is a very good initiative to introduce Indian values, Indian culture, Indian wisdom among the youth. Okay, so that's the primary goal of this Rishikesh University, not to impose Hinduism on other communities. Okay, so clarify this thing in your mind. So that was all about this thing, about this Rishikesh University. Next is that the academic areas include creativity, entrepreneurship, education, healthcare, and public leadership. All of these areas will have some or the other ideas taken from the Indian wisdom, Indian traditional values or texts that we already have. Moving ahead, where will DRDE establish its Advanced Biological Defense Research Center to study viruses dangerous to humans? Here the right answer is Gwalior. So this will be established at Gwalior, Madhya Pradesh, by the DRDE, that is Defense Research Development Establishment, which is an arm of DRDO. Okay. So the basic purpose is to study viruses that are dangerous to human and to develop technological solutions to handle any future epidemic or the spread of pathogens. So that's the basic idea. The director of DRDE is Manohar Parida. Okay. Which state has announced to launch Khel Nursery Scheme 2022 to 2023 to promote sports? Guys, here the right answer is Haryana. So basically under this scheme, the sports nurseries will be established across the state, which will basically promote sports among the children. So that's the basic idea behind launching this Khel Nursery Scheme. So it's the time for our GK Factory section, and the topic that I am going to discuss with you is Oceania. So guys, while I was searching out the facts for you for this topic only, Oceania, I came across a lot of mystic and lot of very interesting things that I am sure that you will also be interested in. So let's begin. First of all, we have been taught that there are seven continents in the world, and the seventh or the sixth one is Australia, which is not so actually. In reality, it's Oceania, which is the continent, and Australia is a part of that continent. So what is Oceania exactly? Oceania is basically the region in the ocean, in the Pacific Ocean, which includes the Australia, New Zealand, and many other island territories, or some of which are independent nations and some of which are the territories or autonomous territories owned by the Europeans or the developed nations. So that's the Oceania. Now, Oceania has been divided into four parts based on the cultural similarities plus geography. So on the geography, on the basis of geography as well as the cultural similarities that these island nations and the people residing in those nations or the territories share with each other. So we have Australasia, Melanesia, Polynesia, and Micronesia. And believe me, guys, the culture, the things that you will get to know in this session, in this particular section of GK Factory, would amaze you, okay? First of all, let's have a look at some of the facts related to Oceania. The area is 85 lakh square kilometers. So area-wise, it is the smallest, okay? Population-wise, it is the second smallest after Antarctica. Obviously, who is going to reside in Antarctica apart from the scientists? Okay, so there are observatories in Antarctica where the scientists reside. Apart from them, nobody resides in Antarctica. And succeeding Antarctica, we have the Oceania region, which has the smallest population in the world, which is over 41 million. Now, guys, this is over. So this is not the exact population, 41 million. Population wise, it is the second after Antarctica. So now let's see the division exactly. Okay. So this is the division. Australasia includes Australia plus New Zealand. Then we have Polynesia. Then we have Micronesia. Then we have Melanesia. All of these regions we are going to discuss in detail because these are very interesting. Okay. Now here I want to draw your attention towards New Zealand, which comes in both of these regions. It also comes in Australasia as well as Polynesia. So New Zealand is the only country that is trespassing both of these regions. Okay, so that's the point. Now let's have a look at the pointers or the boundaries of Oceania. So at the very northwest region, we have Northern Mariana Islands. Okay, so these islands make up the northwestern boundaries. Northeast pe we have Hawaii. Here we have Easter Islands. And here we have New Zealand. So all of these, and in the west, we have Australia. So all of these make up the entire points or the boundaries of Oceania, although there are no actual boundaries in the ocean itself. Okay, so as per the experts, these are the boundaries. But do remember that there are Cocos Island of Australia and Christmas Island. Both of these islands are in the Indian Ocean. Okay, Indian Ocean basically, but still they are a part of Australasia. So that was another interesting fact that I wanted to share with you. Now guys, this is the picture that I have taken from Wikipedia, but you cannot rely on this picture completely. I will tell you why. So can you see this region, French Polynesia and Pitcairn? Here they are shown as the very adjacent landlocked regions, basically the locked regions, okay? Whereas in actuality, the distance between them is this huge, okay? This is French Polynesia and this is Pitcairn Islands. So this is the distance. Now this picture has clubbed or has put all these islands in such close proximity in order to give you a glimpse of all the islands that are there in the Oceania region. So you do not have to take it in actuality. You do not have to memorize this map, okay? Because this is not the authentic map. This is just to show you the number of islands, the major island territories that are there in the Oceania region. So that was the purpose. Now, the largest and the most populous in the Australia, in this Oceania region is the Australia. Okay, region-wise we can also see, the area-wise we can also see that Australia is the very largest area. Plus population is also very huge here because of the industrialization, because of the economic opportunities that this land is offering to the people. Oceania has a diversity of economies. So we have highly developed economies like Australia, New Zealand, New Caledonia, Hawaii, etc., etc. Guys, New Caledonia was in the news recently. I taught you in one of the morning test videos only. So can you tell me that this territory is owned by which country? This is your question. Do tell me in the comment section. Medium-sized economies like Palau, Fiji and Tonga, and small-sized economies like Papua New Guinea, Indonesia, New Guinea, Kiribati, Vanuatu and Tuvalu Islands. So this is again very extra extra fact that you don't have to memorize. Okay, I think here I try to use so many images that you don't need to memorize anything. Okay, coming back to Australasia, we have Australia here and we have New Zealand here. So these two form up the Australasia region. It's the largest of all the Oceania regions that we discussed: Australasia, Polynesia, Micronesia, and Melanesia. Out of those four regions, Australasia is the largest one area-wise. Most populous also. It includes Australia, Cocos, and Christmas Islands of Australia and New Zealand. It's the largest and the most populous, accounting for Australia. Is the largest and the most populous country here, which accounts for almost half of the population of Oceania. This is huge. New Zealand is the only landmass that trespass both the regions, Polynesia and your Australasia. So that was the fact that you need to know. Now guys, Oceania is one region, one continent that is very, very famous for the tribal culture of here. So can we say that no tribes reside here in Australia and New Zealand because of the modernity? Because we see that ecology and economy have a very indirect, inversely proportional relationship. So as industrialization grow, the ecology, which also include tribals in itself, okay, because tribals choose to stay close to nature. So are the tribal people not residing in Australia and New Zealand? Guys, this is not the truth. Tribal people are residing in both of these countries, and I'm going to show you a picture. Okay, so this is the face tattoo that the Maori tribal people of New Zealand do on their face. These are the permanent tattoos. So this itself is showing the rich culture, the rich tribal culture of New Zealand. Don't worry, we are going into the details of all the tribal cultural some of the facts that you would enjoy, I guess. Okay, so that was all about the Australasia. Let's move on to the Polynesia. So after Australasia, Polynesia is the largest region. So let's have a look at the joining codes. Hawaiian Islands, which is a US territory. So I hope that you all have seen the Doraemon. So whenever Sunyu had to go on a picnic, the most favorite destination of his was the Hawaiian Islands. So Hawaii, from there, I used to fascinate a lot about Hawaii Islands, that how would they be. So I have taken some of the pictures from Hawaiian Islands culture only. I'm going to show you that, but let's have a first look at the coordinating points or the area of Polynesia. Easter Islands, which is a territory of Chai. Okay, so they and New Zealand. So all of these regions encompass the Polynesia. Okay, so apart from these three, French Polynesia is a part of it. Then we have Samoa and Tonga. So these are the very major islands that are important, even if even from your exam point of view. So if you want to memorize them, but I don't think that you need to memorize them so hard. Okay, it will help. This picture will help you in memorizing the coordinating points of Polynesia at least. So Polynesia is the largest ocean territory in the entire Oceania. Then the joining cots we have discussed. The Polynesian tribal culture is the most famous of all tribal cultures in the world. Okay, so here, this is these kinds of dancers I have seen in Doraemon also. This is the rich culture of the Polynesia region. And do not forget that New Zealand is also a part of Polynesia. Next comes Melanesia. So Melanesia is this region. So we have discussed Australasia, we have discussed Polynesia. Now we are going to discuss the Melanesia. So what are the major island territories that are a part of it? Papua New Guinea, which is a country itself. Now guys, this country is very, very, we can say this entire region is very, very linguistically rich. This country has more than 800 plus languages, recognized languages. So this rich, this region is that only one country is having more than 800 languages. Then we have Nauru, Solomon Islands, Fiji. Again, Fiji is an important island, Vanuatu and New Caledonia. Okay, so these are the regions in Melanesia. It is the second most populous region of the Oceania and the least discovered region also in terms of its tribal culture. Now, this region has a very mystic identity. I will tell you why. First of all, it is very linguistically diverse area. I told you that only one country has more than 800 languages, and all these countries are very rich that they have many languages. Papua New Guinea has more than 800 recognized languages. Ethnic aboriginals have dark skin. Ethnic tribal people have dark skin, and they are the only people that have dark skin, but they have blonde hair. So that is also another mystique and very interesting thing about the people residing in the Melanesian region. And all of these intrigue me to visit Melanesia, the region, any country of this region one day. Only people in the world to have darker skin with blonde hair. So let me show you. This is, guys, the rich culture of Melanesia. So this is not just the culture of one country, it's the culture of entire region. But due to the similarities in culture, I told you that these regions, these island territories have been grouped into regions. So here you can see from this picture, the only dark-skinned people that have blonde hair. So they have very rough hair, therefore people mistake them as of African descent, but they are not so, okay? Now this is the rich tribal culture here. Next comes the Micronesian region. So Melanesia, the quality of Melanesia is that it's the least discovered of all the regions of Oceania. The quality of Australasia is that it is the most developed region. The quality of Polynesia is that it's the largest territory in the Oceania region, which includes the most industrialized and most developed island nations like Hawaii. We have New Zealand in the part of this Polynesia. We have French territory also. So all of these are part of Polynesia. So we have discussed three regions of Oceania. Now comes the fourth and the final region, which is the Micronesia, which is the smallest of all the regions of Oceania. So here we have Palau, Guam, which is a US territory, Northern Mariana Islands, again US territory, Wake Island, again US territory, Marshall Islands, we have Nauru, we have Kiribati, we have Federated States of Micronesia. Now this is a country, guys, okay? Within the Micronesian region, a country is named Federated States of Micronesia, okay? So I hope that you won't get confused. So it's the smallest of all region and it has a very less population. I tell you why. The reason is that the first of all, the area, the land mass is very scattered and very less, even so much less that the sea level and the level of the land is equal. Okay, so the land is barely above the sea level. So that's how the situation of Micronesia is, and that makes the entire life on Micronesian islands very difficult. Okay, these islands are barely above the sea level. Trade among the countries in the Micronesian region have strengthened their bond. I told you that the land and the sea level both have very equal level. Okay, they are not very above the sea level. The land is not very at a very high level from the sea level. Therefore, these the people who are residing in the islands that are very low would trade the communities, the commodities that they grow there with the islands that have a very high surface, like the islands that have mountains, etc. So the mountains or the high surface area gave them the opportunity to grow crops. So the islanders within the Micronesian region, again, do remember, within the Micronesian region, they are trading with themselves and they are strengthening their bond. So that's one thing. Stone was a very prized commodity in Micronesian past times, okay? Not the present time. Okay, so here comes the most important part. We have discussed the Oceania region. Australia and New Zealand are two countries with which we are definitely strengthening our bond. We have established many partnerships with Australia. New Zealand is also one country where we are trying to open our economic and political, social ties, etc. But are we collaborating with the Pacific Island nations? Yes. The Forum for Indo-Pacific Island Cooperation, Island Nation Cooperation, is one such forum that gives the opportunity to India to strengthen its bond with these Pacific Island Nation countries. Okay. So this is the Forum for India Pacific Islands Cooperation, which is short formed as FIPIC. Okay, I have this picture because Modi ji is here. So 2014 is the year in which FIPIC was established, and therefore I hope that from this picture now you can easily remember the year in which this FIPIC was established and the collaboration that India is trying to open up with the Far East neighbors of ours. Okay, many Oceania countries are members in ISA, International Solar Alliance, like Australia, Fiji. So these countries are already members of the ISA. So in these manners, we are collaborating with the neighbors of ours. So guys, here this session ends. I hope that you are now glad to know these facts about the Oceania region. Thank you so much for watching this video. And if you liked the content, then do not forget to subscribe to the channel and hit the bell notification.